The University Chaplaincy is pleased to have many strong partners and supporters around campus and in the local community who help to make our work truly intersectional and have a wide impact on the connections of spirituality, ethics, and education. And perhaps nowhere is support for our work the strongest as with our special advisor in the Office of the President, Michael Bannon. Together with President Monaco, Michael helps to make sure that the work of spiritual life, the integration of the mind and the heart, thrives at Tufts, and we are so grateful to him. So I'd like to invite Michael to offer some reflections on this past year and on this occasion tonight. Michael, would you please give us some words?
Well, good evening, everybody. I'm pleased to add my welcome to Greg's to this wonderful annual event. The Russell Lecture has a long and very distinguished tradition of speakers, but in recent years, as Greg alluded, what's really remarkable is that it has started to combine, under his and his colleagues' leadership, a tradition of probing moral, ethical, and intellectual reflection with the development of community through an annual dinner that is an opportunity to bring together not only the chaplaincy team and students who are active in religious, philosophical, and spiritual exploration, but also colleagues from across the university who share an interest in the chaplaincy's work, partner with the chaplaincy, and help advance the mission of Greg and his colleagues. So it's wonderful to see so many people from offices, departments, and programs across the university with us this evening. This has become, for me, one of the highlights of every spring. The intellectual and spiritual component of this lecture series reflects the university's commitment to spiritual experience and ethical reflection in a rigorous intellectual context, and I have no doubt that this evening's remarks will carry that tradition forward. I'll just reflect for a moment that I know it's been a busy year for Greg and his colleagues. I do want to single out a few people because this is a year when the chaplaincy has seen a number of new people join the team, all of whom have been already making wonderful contributions. They include Dan Bell, a new Protestant chaplain, Abu Bakr Fakhri Abu Elala, a new Muslim associate, Priya Shraman, our new Buddhist in residence, and Lambert Ramming, whom you heard from earlier, who's taken on the new position of Africana Community Associate. And I wanted to just pause and congratulate Lambert on having been ordained an elder in AME Church just this past weekend. Congratulations, Lamb. I'd also like to point out that in November, the youngest member of the chaplaincy team arrived, Rory Burns Cooper Tripp. We are all so happy for our Catholic chaplain, Lynn Cooper. The academic year got off to a great start with another successful CAFE pre-orientation program. As many of you know, thanks in large part to the efforts of Celine Ibrahim, there's now a new multi-faith room for prayer and meditation at the Fletcher School. Greg and our humanist in residence, Walker Bristol, are both active on the university-wide task force on student mental health and its working groups on undergraduate and graduate and professional student issues. And these are just a few of the sort of top notes that take place, as well as the full range of ongoing programs to meet the spiritual needs of students, faculty, and staff. And I would say that I think that the work of the chaplaincy is especially important today as it reflects the university's commitments to diversity and inclusion, and to the international members of our community. So I would like to offer thanks to Greg and all of his colleagues for the remarkable work that they do on behalf of Tufts. So it's a special pleasure to help welcome the Reverend Sekou to campus. His presence with us tonight is a reminder that faith and spirituality have a vital role to play in contemporary society, that it is up to us to take what we learn from the philosophies and traditions that we hold sacred or meaningful, from our individual learning, contemplation, prayer, and meditation, and put it to use in the world. These questions of how we can join theory and belief with practice and action are ones our chaplaincy actively seeks to engage. They could not be more timely. I know we will all learn from this. On behalf of the university, thank you, Reverend Sekou, for joining us to deliver this year's Russell Lecture.
Thank you so much, Michael. Reverend Sekou, when we initially invited him to give this year's Russell Lecture, he asked, what is the Russell Lecture about? And as Michael mentioned, it's the university's first named lectureship. It started in 1867. I think that makes this year the 150th Russell Lecture, actually. And the lecture's original purpose, as stated in the donor's will, and Linda Karpowicz from the University of Chaplaincy always loves to quote this. It's to discuss the sufficiency of the gospel to meet the reasonable needs of men in both time and eternity. So a small task. And over the years, we've come to interpret this in a very broad way. But the fundamental goal of the lecture is still to bring a word of gospel or good news, a word of support and encouragement, in a time in which there is so much bad news. And there has always been bad news in every year that the Russell Lecture has been offered. But especially recently, we are in a time of some serious concern. And so it feels very appropriate that we have Reverend Sekou here as an activist and a spiritual leader to reflect on the times that we are in. We're honored to have Reverend Sekou with us tonight. He is a Baptist minister, a theologian, an author, a musician, and an activist who has been deeply engaged in the movement for Black lives, as well as many intersecting social justice movements, including youth work, work for economic justice, anti-war movements, and environmentalism. Reverend Sekou was a minister here in Boston at the First Baptist Church of Jamaica Plain around the time of Michael Brown's killing in Ferguson. We have some JP folks here. And around the time of Michael Brown's killing, and having been born in St. Louis, he heard a call to return to Missouri to bring his ministry to the streets and help to amplify the issues of social justice that needed addressing in Ferguson and in so many places around our country, as we have seen. Reverend Sekou brings to his work a depth of spiritual wisdom and resources and a perspective on prophethood that seeks to advance a divine vision for our society and world today. It's a great honor to have him here to speak with us on these profound matters in our times. Please join me and the chaplains and all of our generous supporters in welcoming Reverend Sekou to campus.
I'm gonna let it shine, oh, this light of mine. I'm gonna let it shine, oh, this little light of mine. I'm gonna let it shine, let it shine, let it shine, everywhere I go. I'm gonna, oh, everywhere I go. I'm gonna let it shine, oh, yeah, let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Assalamu alaikum. Kevahalik. Alhamdulillah. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillah. Nur Rahman, Nur Rahim, Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, Nur Rahman, Nur Rahim, Melikiomidini Yakana Aburua Yakana Staina Denosaraltal Mustakin Saraltalazin and Antalehim Gairil Makdubi Alakin Waledolin. Amin. We say those words, Fatiha, at a moment where being Muslim is criminalized, and that the act of speaking Arabic is a revolutionary act. For our Muslim brothers and sisters in the room, pray with you. I want to thank Reverend Greg and Sister Linda, who helped get me here. It's a bit hard to keep track of. Linda's work in counseling, and Reverend Lambert, for all of you who are here on the occasion, 150th Russell Lecture. I want to take a little time for us to wrestle critically together. I am a third generation Pentecostal preacher, but I will attempt to be uncharacteristically brief. But we indeed live in monstrous times. And so our task this evening is to wrestle with the question, what is the role of the prophet in the time of monsters? Perhaps it is in our childhood that we come to know and love monsters. Our childhoods are filled with scary things that go bump in the night. The images of a ferocious, fire-breathing creature with bulging eyes and fangs and foaming at the mouth stands over us. We pull the covers over our head. We pray and pretend that the monster is just a figment of our imagination. But monsters are real. History is peopled with millions of corpses that are left in their wake. Monsters indeed, though they are not rare. We rattle off their names with great ease, and we often compare monsters of the past to our present brute. Monsters carry out individual atrocities, but they carry a far more sinister characteristic. They conceal our complicity, which is far more scarier than the monsters themselves. Not only do we hide from monsters, we hide behind monsters. The nations have always bred monsters. Perhaps one could argue that the very nature of the nation state is to breed monsters. And nations love monsters, but not their prophets. For prophets know that all nations are morally bankrupt, that all politics are diseased. But the task of the prophet is to remind us that monsters are not new. Albert Camus, speaking of the artist, says that the task of the artist must never side with those who are the makers of history, but rather those who are the victims of it. The victims will be legion, Muslims, black, queer, young, old, undocumented, woman, femme, differently abled, and above all, the poor. So then prophets must be lobbyists for the languishing. While monsters spew vile words, prophets cannot take any delight in such language, because demonization cannot defeat demagogues. Audre Lorde taught us that when we use the master's tools, we become the master's tool. So then prophets do not shame those who are living in the night. Prophets call us to the light. Part of our understanding of the task of the prophet within the context of late modernity, in this particular age in which we live in, is to be what James Baldwin says of artists, that the task of the artist, that the artist's quarrel with their nation is a lover's quarrel. And so then let us quarrel as lovers do. Prophets are not politicians. They are legislators of hope, parliamentarians of possibility. To be sure, the past is a guide, but melancholy can be a nation's undoing. You see, nostalgia is a form of mourning, because the present is unbearable and the future unforeseeable. When the present obscures the future and undermines the past, the prophet is called to be a diplomat between the world that was, the world that is, and the world that we hope to be. And so then the prophet's allegiances can never be to a nation, a flag, or a party. Love is the government of the prophet. When monsters say that we should lay down and die, that the task of the prophet is a sacred one, which is to make home from rubble that is held together by the very thing that monsters have often sought to snuff out. And that is joy. Prophets are called to be architects of being, building communities where there are no strangers, only neighbors. And monsters fear that. Part of our understanding of what the prophet is has to begin with those of us who do the work of religion to understand who has the right to engage in theological agency, who has the right to authorize the way in which we come to understand the sacred, divine, and notions of ultimate meaning. And for those of us who are Christian, our task becomes even greater. In fact, often I see myself as a missionary to Christianity in an attempt to save it from itself. Part of our troubles begin with an understanding which I believe is in a question for those who are Christian. And again, I am not here to recruit anybody. In fact, I would prefer many of the Christians would convert to other religions. It would make my job a lot easier. But I believe part of our understanding of the moment in which we end begins with a Christological problem. The person of Jesus. That Christological problem for me is mediated by what I call a Pentecostal hermeneutic of suspicion. By a Pentecostal hermeneutic of suspicion, I am concerned with the ways in which we read the signs and wonders of our times. How do we speak in tongues of democracy and language of inclusion? That Christological problem begins with me understanding who has the right to do theological agency. And I begin with the greatest theologian that I have ever known, my grandmother, who had a third grade education. My grandmother did not go to a seminary, but one had been through her. And she articulated a vision of the world that understood that there was darkness, but it did not let the darkness have the last word. She engaged in rich theological descriptions in the context of her own community by saying, Jesus is a bright and morning star. Acknowledging the darkness, never letting the darkness have the last word. And so then I want to make this Christological intervention and an existential intervention. For me, across religion, religion is primarily a meaning-making activity. What are the ways that we make meaning for ourselves in light of circumstances not of our own choosing? And it begins with the ways in which we read this particular historical moment. And so for a methodological attempt, that we offer two examples. The person of Jesus in the terms of a Christological intervention, understanding that religion primarily is an existential act, and then an historical intervention, an attempt to correct much of the misnomers that we have engaged in. And so we'll do so by looking at the life of legacy of Martin Luther King. So I begin with a certain set of dialogical assumptions in this Christological intervention. I begin with a simple proclamation. Jesus was a nigger. And to be a nigger now and then is to contend with the arbitrary violence, the legislative repression, and ontological uncertainty. Every moment of one's life is policed and every action is questioned. Where and how a nigger lives is subjugated to interrogation. Jesus, like all niggers, is empirically unjustifiable, yet existentially irrefutable. He came from an infamous little place that was known for nothing good. The nigger's story sounds more like a blues man filled with too much Jack Daniels and too little hope, singing in an empty juke joint early Sunday morning. He was born in the body of an unwed teenage mother among an unimportant people in an unimportant part of the world as a Palestinian living under occupation. His birth carried the stench of illegitimacy. It was rumored that he was the son of a rapist Roman centurion, but his mother claimed that he was the son of God, her people's liberation. Though they would be torn asunder, they gathered about him, a ragged movement whose dogged spirit was held only together by a simple belief that freedom was coming. Everywhere they went, refugees gathered and left, believing that there was something greater than the empire. Yet corrupt religious leaders conspired with the empire to silence dissonance and orchestrate hierarchical harmony, rendering justice mute. To live under occupation without resistance is a self-portrait of hate. Thus, religious leaders attempting to navigate a treacherous political terrain often sided with the powers that be. But Jesus, this nigger, and his nigger followers were challenging the meaning of what it meant to be Palestinian living under occupation by treating the needs of their people as holy. Their troubled religious leaders and political elites' conceptions of themselves, a refusal to believe that the empire has said what the empire has said about you is to be free, while their hearts were bent toward silencing him. The greatest offense was disrupting the financialization of the court of the poor, which is the house of the prayer. Jesus so disrupted the empire that he was arrested on false charges, convicted in a kangaroo court, crucified with two other insurrectionists. He was executed by the state, and the day of his state-sanctioned execution is called good. Every day in America, every other day in America, is Good Friday. Death at the hands of the state. It happens so often that the news of such tragedy elicits a rather ordinary response. They killed another one. And as the death toll rings throughout Christendom's past, state violence is ever present. Ferguson, then, America's Nazareth. And it has given birth to a new theology at work in the world. And the irrelevance of the church was made evident on the streets of Ferguson, the Tahrir Square of the Midwest. In the early days of August of 2004, poor, queer, black, and female Jesus took up a cross and faced tanks and tear gas and rubber bullets. And in the life of most of the young folks on the streets, the church has been a site of condemnation and rejection, and dare I say, the mosque and the synagogue. It is in the street the righteous indignation of God in the flesh came to us yet again, night after night, consumed in the bellowing smoke of tear gas clouds. A cry from the wilderness could be heard. Fuck the police. Religious leaders were more concerned with young people's profanity than they were the profane conditions that they lived in. Early in the morning, lowly and angry, still they rose. If there is no remission of sin without the shedding of blood, then Michael Brown's blood might be our salvation. You see, to strip Jesus' cross of its political content is to contribute to the lie that black lives do not matter. For Jesus, a first century nigger who led a love rebellion against the empire, was crucified. And this moment in the liturgical calendar signifies what is happening to God in the flesh. A Palestinian peasant who was crucified at the hands of the state and blessed by apostate religious leaders. And let us be sure that we do not engage in any forms of anti-Semitism, or the conditionedness of the first century Jew is the conditionness of the black poor. Jesus, who was no more than a handyman, shook the Roman Empire at its core. We live in an empire with over 1,000 bases around the world, dropping some 26,000 bombs in 2015 alone. And that part of the story of empire is that it is always obsessed with taking profits and smoothing off their radical edges and making their profane speech polite speech. This is what we have done to Jesus, and this is what we have done to Dr. King. Kwame Reed, the Black Democratic mayor of Atlanta, said this of Martin Luther King: "The only thing I ask is that we do not take freeways," speaking of Black Lives Matter activists. Dr. King would never take a freeway. There was a certain irony there. An even noted conservative talk show host, Bill O'Reilly, has postulated with great confidence that Dr. King would not participate in Black Lives Matter's protest. Though Reed and O'Reilly were quickly lambasted for their lack of historical accuracy, their sentiment reveals our popular understanding of America's favorite civil rights leaders. Liberals and conservatives alike appropriate Martin Luther King to justify certain political aims and to buttress their opposition to contemporary social movements. In the same manner, corporations such as Apple have used Dr. King's word and image to sell their wares, and pundits of all persuasions have used his popularity to browbeat younger activists and their tactics. Such is the case for the movement of Black Lives, and such has been the critique of many of those who have made their observation of young people in the streets of Ferguson. Often denigrated in public discourse, Black Lives Matter is the latest and the largest social movement since the Civil Rights Movement. The Civil Rights Movement and Dr. King are often held up as counterweights to the Black Lives Matter movement. We are never told in our romantic and popular story about Dr. King, about his limited popularity that he endured in the latter part of his life. Yet Black Lives Matter does not share in Dr. King's contemporary popularity. Again, the irony is both latent and manifest. A series of polls taken during the better part of 1963 through 1967 offered data on Dr. King's popularity with the American public. Although he was America's most admired man in 1965 and 1964, respectively, Dr. King never enjoyed a favorability rating over 41%. Between 1966 and 1968, Dr. King did not appear among the top 10 on Gallup's most admired list. In 1961, according to the poll, King had a 41% positivity rate and a 37% negativity rate. In 1964, the year that he won the Nobel Peace Prize and that the Civil Rights Act was passed, there was a slight bump in his popularity, 43% positive, 39% negative. The same year that Lyndon Johnson signed the Voting Rights Act, 1965, King's rating was 45% positive and 45% negative. A year later, his popularity plummeted. He had a 63% negative poll rating. By August of 1966, a mere 12% of all Americans had a favorable opinion of Dr. King. Later that year, a Hall poll asked whether or not Dr. King was helping or hurting the Negro cause. 50% of white respondents believed that he was hurting the cause. Only 36% believed that he was helping. This tepid acceptance of Dr. King was par for the course at the height of the Civil Rights Movement. According to 1961 Gallup poll, most Americans were not on the activist side. A whopping 61% said that they disapproved of what the Freedom Riders were doing, and that the same poll illustrated that the vast majority of Americans felt freedom buses, lunch counter sit-ins, and other demonstrations were hurting black folks' chances of being integrated in the South. With 50% of Americans believing that King and young activists were damaging their cause, a lowly 12% agreed with Dr. King. Our contemporary version of King is strikingly different, much of as our contemporary understanding of Jesus. However, in 1999, a Gallup poll special interest procedure determined that Dr. King was one of the most admired persons in the 20th century, second only to Mother Teresa. With a national monument to boot, King is surely an icon, but he did not bode well in public perception when he was alive. What is even more telling is the fact that the public response to the work of Dr. King and the civil rights movement is very similar to that of Black Lives Matter. In September 2015, PBS NewsHour and MERS pollsters conducted a survey and asked respondents, from what you've heard and seen about Black Lives Matter, do you mostly agree or mostly disagree with Black Lives Matter, or do you have an opinion either way? Only 34% of adults agreed with BLM. Less than a third of Americans believed BLM focused on the real issues of racial discrimination, while 55% said that the movement distracts from these its real issues. According to a poll conducted by NBC News, Wall Street, and only 32% of Americans had a positive view of Black Lives Matter. 29% mostly negative views, and 39% were neutral. Again, in 1966, 57% of those polled believed freedom rides and other demonstrations would hurt the civil rights cause. And in 2015, 55% of those believed that Black Lives Matter actions were distracting from the issues. The numbers between Black Lives Matter and Martin Luther King are in a statistical heat. The U.S. public responded to the civil rights movement and Black Lives Matter movement in the same way, believing that both movements were undermining their mission. These polling numbers beg a different set of questions. What does MLK, Black Lives Matter, share their public scorn? What do they have in common that facilitates said scorn? I believe that much of the discourse that we experience, particularly around religion and the civil rights movement, in which you hear young people say that I am not religious, I am, and that much of what my dear brother Tef Poe, when he said that this is not your daddy's civil rights movement, both instances, there's a commonality that they are responding to a popular construction of religion and not its prophetic heart, and a popular construction of the Martin Luther King's legacy in the civil rights movement, not its prophetic edge. For many observe in the context of religion, oftentimes I tell my atheist friends when they tell me they don't believe in God, and they describe the God that they don't believe in, I tell them, I don't believe in that God either. So when we think about a certain commonality between the life and legacy of Jesus and the life and legacy of Martin Luther King, to deify neither, but rather to engage in a form of historical criticism that helps us keep track of the social phenomena and the social context that they existed in, helps us come to an understanding of this particular moment, that the task of the prophet in the time of monsters is to always be a truth teller. And to be a truth teller is to be honest. We lie to young people and we argue with them and we act as though everybody over 50 marched with Martin Luther King. I go to lectures around the country and some elder makes it their duty to tell me that they were on the bridge in Selma. If all the people who say they were on the bridge in Selma, the daggum thing would have collapsed. And then when we make a myth around the ways in which Jesus, being a simple, meek, mild Prince of Peace, who was only about love as though he had no concern for the poor. That the tragic reality is the vast majority of white evangelicals voted for a monster, justifying it in the context of their religion. Understanding the ways in which Jesus has been appropriated in the same way King has been appropriated, in such a way that Jesus looks more like a CEO. I believe Jesus looked more like Michael Brown, born to an unwed teenage mother among an unimportant people in an unimportant part of the world, living under occupation, subject to the arbitrary violence of the state, religious leaders making negotiations around the state in such a way, thinking that they were attempting to care for the needs of their people. You remember those instances in the biblical narrative, one of them being, if a man makes you walk a mile, you walk 2 miles. This is an act of resistance because the Jewish leadership has cut a deal with the Roman Empire and said, look, you can't make our people just walk, because they were subject to the arbitrary violence of the state. And so then the rule that they cut, the kind of reform in the system, was you will not make our people walk. And so Jesus says to them in that context in which the reform was having some discipline of the system, that if they make you walk, because they can do it, you walk another mile as a form of resistance in your own agency. If a man takes your coat, give him your outer coat, give him your inner coat, because to appear naked in that context was a sign of shame upon the viewer. Turn the other cheek. Because within the context of first century Palestine, if I was going to slap someone who was not my equal, I would slap them with my backhand. And so when Jesus says, turn the other cheek, it is a demand that you slap them with an open hand as though you were slapping a peer. These are acts of resistance in the context of the biblical narrative. And these acts of resistance in the context of the biblical narrative say to us that we must, if we are be serious about the prophetic tradition of Christianity, and to be sure, Christianity does not have a monopoly on the prophetic tradition. We got it from the Jewish brothers and sisters. What doth the Lord require? Do justice, love mercy, and to walk humbly. Some of the law is to love the Lord thy God with all the heart, mind, and the soul, and to love thyself. Christian tradition that finds its origin within the best of the prophetic tradition that we receive. This is the tradition that King is. Concerned. Clergy are oftentimes more concerned with heaven sweet by and by than the hell that people are catching on earth now. Young people say that they are rejecting the church in particular, rejecting the civil rights movement. They are not rejecting the prophetic edge. They're rejecting the lie. The task of the prophet is to speak truth. The task of the prophet is to look. Again, we began as a point of departure in terms of our methodological critique of a prophetic, of a rather Pentecostal hermeneutic of suspicion. Suspicion requires us to look at history and to look at text, and to wrestle with them in different and new informed ways. While the best of the prophetic tradition is on the edges of the tradition, we argue that it is the heart of the faith. And Christianity does not have a monopoly on that. laws of cause and effect through sound. That sounds like you reap what you sow. Back to the beginning of all Muslim gatherings, oftentimes it begins with A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitan Rajeem. God from Satan. In acknowledgement of the darkness. And then that next greeting, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Telling the truth about the darkness, but not letting the darkness have the last word. The task of the prophet in this time is to keep track of that darkness, honor it, to say what it is. Power, part of our task and part of our responsibility, must be willing again to tell the truth to young people about the world in which they live. We are indeed in monstrous times. No question about it. Now, the reality for black folks in America, we've been living in a monstrous time for about 400 years. And so this is why I end on the existential note. How will we make meaning for ourselves in this context? Who do we look to? Who has the resources? What folks have engaged in this? Who has the right to engage in theological agency? What stories matter now? This is why I begin with the poor. Those of you who potentially will find yourselves as religious creatures, perhaps serving your community in various ways, I ask that you reject the evangelical impulse. You are not bringing God and goodness to anyone. Goodness is already there. We just pray that you have the eyes to see it. Much of this comes from in my work at First Baptist Jamaica Plain. I used to run a youth open mic there. I invited Stacey Ann Chin, the great queer poet. Lily said the word pussy 37 times in my church. And I knew I was gonna get fired. They gonna fire me, this is it. Then my little old church lady, they said, Reverend, we really like that Stacey Ann. When are you bringing her back? Paul Williams came to my church and said the word fuck 47 times in the sanctuary. I understood something was happening there. The task of the church and the task of the prophet is not to bring, as the great Julius Nyerere, the task of the prophet is not to descend like an ancient god and give a political speech and think that we've made our contribution. Communities are not developed. They develop themselves. And we must be part of that process. And so what those queer kids taught me at that church is that my only responsibility, and I would argue the responsibility of the prophet, is to hold space that others might get free. And that the other reality is that in holding that space, we get free ourselves. I'm a little bit freer as a cisgendered man because some queer kids taught me some pronouns. That we come to understand that there is no movement against anti-Semitism in the world until we fundamentally honor the humanity of Palestinian brothers and sisters. That our movements and that our solidarity, that there is no freeing of men until we honor the humanity of women, that there is no freeing of straight people until we honor the humanity of queer people, because our humanity is tied up in a way that requires all of us to struggle together. And for the white folks in the room, I'll end on this existential note, that there's a discourse in America that is also part and parcel of a postmodern obsession with individuality and atomizing the ways in which we come to understand not structural oppression, but individual forms of racism. And so we have an obsession in our public discourse around white privilege. I like to talk about white supremacy. There's this idea that great Adrian Smith talks about, the ways in which the discourse about privilege, as though going to a workshop is going to make you free. The white folks I trust, I've been to jail with. They know my children's names. And folks come up to me, they say, Reverend Sekou, you know, I'm an anti-racist white person. I've been to these anti-racist workshops. That's interesting. My next question to them is, have you ever been to a black funeral? Did somebody love you enough that when they putting their mama in the ground, they want you standing next to them? That is solidarity. Quote all of Michelle Alexander you want. But are you in relationship with a community of people who are engaging in struggle? So the task of the prophet is not only to speak truth to power, to be a truth teller in all spaces and in all times. It is not only holding space, but the last task of the prophet is that will you be part of a community of people who are willing to struggle? Not always agree to fuss and to fight. And in that struggle together, how do you engage in the work in such a way that you give joy and get joy out of the work? I've met a lot of mean activists in my time. I'm for peace, damn it. But does the work fill you? The great Gordon Cosby once said to me, I was having one of those existential crises, you know. I'm a black man and I'm a preacher, so I think I'm the next Martin Luther King. I talked about all the sacrifices that you had to go, and he looked at me and he said, son, if the work is not feeding you, you're doing something wrong. How does the work feed you? How does it make you stronger? Frantz Fanon says, we struggle not only for the product of struggle, but we benefit from the process. In our struggle to become freer, we ought to become freer people. Paul Story says, I wake up every morning trying to squeeze the slave out of me, drop by drop. And as for those of you who are activists, it is to say that if you live in a cesspool, everybody smells like shit. My grandmother would say, she says, you can't live in a whorehouse and not turn a trick. Somehow, and this is not to demonize sex workers, I think they should have a union. But it is to say that you're going to be participating in the economy if you live in a morally bankrupt system. So don't ever get too full of yourself that you've all got the answers and you know everything. Don't engage in purity tests. They don't know. My grandmother was a homophobe. You remember in the 80s when you could wear sweaters on your shoulders? I couldn't do it. Grandmother thought it looked too gay. Oh, but if a gay person was hungry, she knew about feeding them. She would love them. She would care for them. Her table was open to them. So what are the ways are we engaging in communities, in speaking truth, holding space, being in community that does not create outsiders? As we said at the beginning, Audre Lorde warned us that we can't use the master's tools. But we don't shame each other. Stay off Twitter and Facebook. When Sekou does something homophobic, you call him and you tell him. You can only do that when you know his name. Brother Rabbi and I were just talking about great Rabbi Susan Talvey. We disagree on Palestine and fight like cats and dogs over. I've been to jail with her. That doesn't mean when I disagree or if I think she's wrong, I don't hold her accountable. And she doesn't do it. And that doesn't mean when she thinks I'm being sexist, she don't hold me accountable. But we're in relationship. I'm right. But we're in relationship. Do you understand me? I'll say this lastly. We are depending on you. Our names, Hebrews 11 and 1 says that faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. Somebody willed you here. Some slave on some plantation dreamed of an opportunity for folks from all over the world to be able to sit together and be engaging in education. You are the substance of what they hoped for. There was someone in a Auschwitz taking their last breath with you in mind. Some child in Gaza lost their legs. Walk for them. Trans kid in a sex trade, hoping that you will defend them and speak in their defense. There is some woman subject to the arbitrary violence of her partner, hoping you will. Willing to do that. Say of you. Say of me. There stood a generation of men and women who were willing to put their bodies on the line for those who do not matter. There was a generation of men and women who understood the radical legacy of Martin Luther King, and the best of the prophetic tradition is exemplified in the life of Jesus. They'll say of you and they'll say of me, well done. Thank you. Thank you. So I think we're going to do a little question, queries, comments, and outrage. Yes, sir. I mean, I think particularly in the context of a, I actually think so there's been, say, for instance, a lot of protests when like a right winger comes to campus, right? I think that's a good example. I think two things can exist at once. Richard Spencer, is that his name? The really, really right wing one? Or the one who, the boy I can't never stand. Milo, is that the boy's name? You know what I'm talking about? I think in the context of an academic setting, he has the right to come speak. I believe in a free exchange of ideas, and I think students have the right to protest him. Both of those can exist. So, and that's what I mean. And in the context of freedom of the press, freedom of ideas, to acknowledge the damage that those kinds of speeches do. Right? Because you want to be concerned about censoring, because censorship never works well for liberals, by the way. They come for that speech first. Right? But you want to be able to acknowledge those truths, right? So in the context, like, as someone who supports revolutionary struggle, Fidel says to me, or Chavez says to me, or Evo in Bolivia says to me, there's no racism here. Okay, take me to your jails. And I can tell you whether or not it's some racism. I think what you're doing is a great thing around free education, free healthcare, all of that, they can coexist, right? But Dale outlawed jazz, which I just think he outlawed James Brown because he thought it was Western bourgeois music. You know, you're just born in the wrong part of the world, that's all. But both of them can exist. Free healthcare, strong doctors, high literacy, free education, and they still can be wrong on those questions. Same thing, free speech, students got the right to protest it. Other queries, comments? Yes. Well, I think that part of it, okay, how do you be in the activist community but not be exclusionary? Is that the good summation? Because communities, like people make communities, they naturally exclude, right? So I think there are a couple things. One is the question of like, why do all the black kids sit together in the cafeteria, right? Part of a truth is that part of it is that these are hostile environments a lot of times for, say, students of color or queer kids or women, right? I think having those spaces are important for folks to kind of make some sense and get some sense, you know? Like, you speak Arabic, you probably want to talk Arabic to somebody. So that's natural. The question is that when the imposition of those exclusionary groups, that we can't make the choice between, we can't make the assumption that the choice of self, quote unquote, segregation, right, is the same thing as having 3% black students here. Those are not the same thing. Individual choices about how they construct community is very different than systematic repression. And when you make certain choices I'm an old line modernist, meaning that I believe in old school right and wrong, oppressed, oppression. You know, I can traffic in the language of postmodern discourse, which I think is interesting and made some great contributions to the way in which Western thinking functions. But I also believe that there's the oppressed and oppressor. I believe there's good and evil, right? And that people are gonna make political and ideological choices. And you can make those political and ideological choices and still try to attempt to be in community with people. But if I hate Muslims and I think Islam is the evil religion in the world, it's probably gonna be hard for me to hang out with the Muslim chaplain. But you see what I'm saying? So yes, there are moments where people are making choices about what they're going to struggle against. I just want to hold space for people to be, quote unquote, born again, to catch the light. Because think about here in Boston, in the 1945, 1955, we don't know Malcolm's going to be Malcolm. We just know Detroit Red. Bob Zellner, names many of you all should know. Bob Zellner, born to a racist right-wing family. And one of the most famous pictures of a white dude bleeding nose, getting beat for the civil rights movement, Bob Zellner. We don't know he's going to be that. And so I want to hold space for the possibility of people growing while holding them, and while they're in that possibility of growing, that we're limiting the damage that they're doing. Because folks are actually getting hurt. That's not an abstraction. You know, not only in terms of emotional and individual psychic trauma, people are actually getting hurt. And so we want to hold space for people to grow while also protecting. So the answer, that's a long-winded answer to say that it's complex. Yes, ma'am. Well, I think there are a couple things, right? So Chris Crass raises an interesting question. You know, what we often do, and universities are guilty of this as well, in our language about diversity and inclusion, we lose track of the systematic structure. So if you get three or four black kids who are third, fourth generation college, who contextually, right, are very much like their white colleagues. They're still going to experience some racism, but their context facilitates in such a way because of their class standing that their experience is going to be a lot different than the kid who's first generation. All right, so what are the ways in which you're creating opportunities and resources for folks to survive in these institutions, right? So that's one. But more pointedly, I think, as Chris notes, I'm at times less concerned with how many black folks they got in the room and more concerned about what blows are they striking against white supremacy. Now, if it's a room just full of white folks doing it, the conversation of white supremacy might not come up. So there needs to be some moral arbiter in that space and in that context to wrestle with that question. I think that also in those spaces, something can happen, right? So like the workshops can be a gateway drug. You know, you go to a little workshop and they teach you how not to be racist, right? Right, and then you might get radicalized. Like I saw that with Katrina. So I know a woman who got more money than God. Saw Katrina, could not believe that happened in America and loaded up a truck and drove it herself to Louisiana. And got radicalized. Now she raises money for black left organizations. So I think more pointedly, what I would prefer in those instances that people are in communities of struggle. Take, for instance, Grace Lee Boggs. How many of you all know that name? So Grace Lee Boggs was the first Asian American to get a PhD in philosophy in America. She marries a black union worker who was part of the Revolutionary Workers Union in Detroit, black radical named James Boggs. If you listen to her speeches in the 80s, in the 70s and the 80s, or in the 60s, she'll talk about the Negro community. I'm not a Negro, right? I can never have that experience, but since I'm in America, this is the struggle I want to be in. Oh, but about 2000, she's saying we. And don't nobody ever question Grace's blackness. I was at a memorial service. It was about 95% black. But Grace had done the work. She'd invested in young people. She had organized with black folks and had struggled faithfully in a way where nobody ever questioned it. Right? And so oftentimes I feel like what we do, because of the postmodern culture that is obsessed with individualization and balkanization and uniqueness as it relates to questions of how we engage in critical struggle, that we lose track of the reality of struggling in these communities. So who are you in relationship with and who are you struggling with? How are you working in solidarity in these communities? And a lot of times it's going into these communities and showing up and shedding up. Like in Ferguson, we had this thing when we knew the police was gonna whoop us. You hear somebody yell, John Brown. That was for the white allies to come. Stand on the front. One, it would repel, oftentimes it would slow the police down so the black activists and some of the folks who couldn't risk the arrest could get out. That's the kind of sacrifice I'm more interested in. Or also how, and also part of white folks' work, like I actually don't think the lead point in West Virginia and Appalachian needs to be BLM. I think the lead point in places like Kentucky, for instance, right? So in Kentucky, you know, Kentucky is gonna, when they were threatening Obamacare, Kentucky has the highest number of folks who benefited from Obamacare. But the way they did it was, because of the racialized nature of Obamacare, they called it Kentucky Connect. So white folks who voted for Trump, who were about to lose their health care, if this thing would have passed, was like, yeah, Obamacare is bad, and I'm protected because I got a Kentucky Connect. You see what I'm saying? So they didn't understand that they had been organized in such a way against their own interests. To me, that needs to be the leading point in Kentucky. In Appalachia, it's mountaintop removal, meth addiction, and some alternative to the coal industry. Right? So that's what I'm saying. I feel like those are the kinds of things that we need to be wrestling with. How are we looking at the particular areas and wrestling with them? We'll take one more. Go ahead, sis. Yes. Oh, I organize my life around parties. I mean, by around joy, who I'm gonna hang out with, who I'm gonna spend time with. And I actually enjoy it. I actually enjoy the work. I just decided a long time ago that if I'm going to be in this, because I ain't gonna make a lot of money doing it, what I am going to do is have joy in doing it and not take myself too seriously. And if the work is not feeding you, you might want to chill out for a minute. Because your burnout does not, and I reject much of this discourse about self-care. Because I think it's often grounded in petty bourgeois formations such as spa days. Which I'm not against spa days. So I just know that that's, self-care happens in the context of community. It's who you love with, it's who you eat with. Right? Who you care for, who's looking out for, who's telling you, baby, go home now. It's time for you to go home. I got this. Like I think self-care happens in the context of community. But also for the major religions of the world, the Messiah has already come. So alleviate yourself of that responsibility. and just find joy, like literally do find joy in the work. If it's a meditative practice, if it's some form of prayer life, is it hanging out with people, is it laughing and finding joy in those particular spaces that may be different and that you need to come to have that joy as a something that is feeding you. But that's, yeah, I get up every, and I'm not a person who's done it well. I'm not standing before you as some kind of moral arbiter of all that is good and decent. I am struggling trying to make some sense of the world and try to leave it a little better than I found it. But not taking yourself too seriously is a really, really big and important. You don't have all the answers. You're in your 20s. You don't know much of nothing. 40's smooth sailing, though, as you stop caring. But in all seriousness, don't take yourself too serious. And just try to love your way through it. Give yourself breaks. And the way oppression works is probably going to be around here for a while. So if you take a break and then come back, it'll still be here. Because humans have this uncanny knack to do mean things to one another. And then they also have amazing capacities to love. So love ye one another. Thank you. I just want to say that I set a goal on the 150th anniversary of the Russell Lecture to drop the most F-bombs ever dropped in a lecture, and I think I did it.
We thank you for all the words you brought. Thank you. Thank you for bringing your joy to us and a powerful word tonight. We have a small token of
tough
love for you.
Thank you.
For the road. Thank you so much.
Thank you so very much.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, everyone, for being here tonight, especially thank you to Zach Cole and Linda Karpowicz and Shelby Carpenter from the chaplaincy, everyone who's helped to make this possible. Our good friend Dale Bryan in Peace and Justice Studies asked us to lift up an event tomorrow, Beyond Vietnam, A Time to Break the Silence, a film about King's famed Beyond Vietnam speech. It's tomorrow at 3:30 in Tisch 316. We'll put information at the back if you're interested in learning about that. We invite you to also look at the upcoming Spiritual Life programs that are printed in your printed program. Many amazing opportunities coming up this month, not only in the chaplaincy, but we're promoting ours tonight. Thank you so much for being here, and we look forward to staying in conversation on these issues. Thank you, Reverend Sekou, again.